So you heard about women artists. So speak up, girls.
Well, for a woman artist to do cars and things too, that's a lot of the women more womanish things.
When I painted my first Cadillac, I didn't think, oh gosh, I'm a woman and I'm painting a Cadillac instead of washing the dishes. Men are dress designers. They're playing with dolls, so to speak. What's the difference between painting a beautiful Cadillac or a Ferrari than painting a portrait of something else, a dog or a person?
Are you the only female artist with the Automobile Fine Arts Society?
Oh, be careful. Yes. There was one when I joined, but she packed it in quite quickly. What really started me off was I had a friend whose wife, out of the blue, young, like 35 years old or what have you, had a heart attack and died, just like that, you know, gone. And that was kind of one of the many wake-up calls I had. And I decided I wanted to paint that. I don't want to just die not doing what I wanted to do, but I really wanted to paint. I wanted oil paint. I wanted the smell of the oil paint. I hope it comes through.
Do you always begin with photographs? Is that the process?
Yeah, I do.
Okay.
I have to have, and I have to take them myself. One, for copyright reasons, and two, I like my angles. I know what my angles. I know how to make a car look good, you know, from the angles I shoot it. So I can't just pick something up out of a magazine. Although for the other inspiration, I do use, I am inspired by magazines, Vogue,
Why is it always the rear end of the car that's more interesting to you?
Because in the 50s, which is the 59 Cadillac was the beginning, I mean, the rear end of that car is just stunning. I mean, it's you can see it over there, but it's like got the bullets and all the chrome and all the detail. So the front of the car wasn't... wasn't quite as interesting. However, with something like this, this is a racing, a very famous racing car. That was its best angle.
How do you create such a precise photorealistic image with oil? And there's no brush strokes. It's so smooth.
It all comes down to practice, 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 you know? You never stop learning if you're programmed that way. I learned to draw very early on, and I think if you learn to draw, you learn to see. And when you learn to see, somebody said your life is what you notice. When I was 15, this art teacher at the previous school went to see my mother and said, your daughter should go to art school. I can get her an interview at Southport School of Art. And hey presto, I did some drawings, put them in a little tiny portfolio when I was 15, and went to, and I got accepted. And that was the beginning of my life. It rescued me. But my mother told me I was no good. One day she got really angry, and I'd already locked the door because Norrie, my stepfather, were fighting. And anyway, she banged the door, I opened the door, and she comes in, she's mad at me. She's mad at me because I'm growing up, probably. I just started going to art school. So, and my grandfather used to have these cutthroat razors, you know, the ones that close and the ones that they have to. And I inherited those to sharpen my pencils with. They were very sharp. and the braids were quite long. And I had them on the windowsill, and my mother grabbed one of these and was going to strike me with it. And my father, my stepfather, saw it through the window. I was taller than my mother by then, and I pushed her away. And he said, "You can't stay here with her like this." I'd made friends with a girl at Southport Art School, and I was taken there. Remember, we didn't have phones in those days either. There was just like 3 or 4 blocks away, there was one of those nice red boxes. I left home and went to live in Southport. I lived in a little place called Great Crosby. I went and got a job at the local cinema selling ice cream from a tray around your neck with a spotlight coming on it. And you walk up and down the aisle. And that was my very first job for rent, to rent a room. Well, it was hardly a room, but with a very nice lady. She liked having me there and liked hearing stories of me selling the ice cream. And one time I dropped all the peanuts and and she had, I was screaming, "Peanuts, peanuts," in bed one night, because I was horrified that I'd actually done that. That's when I fell in love with James Dean. I saw the first movie he made every night for 7 days or however long. This is James Dean's Porsche. And this has a story, because I'd just joined the Automotive Fine Arts Society, and I'd taken this painting, and I hadn't put it up on the wall yet, and this little guy comes around and buys it and knocks me down in price. They all do. Rich people just have, they all buy wholesale. Anyway, I didn't know who he was or whatever, and I'd agreed to sell it. And then the ladies that were with him said, "You know who he is?" You know, and he actually owned the car. In the case of the Delahays, I've done 2 for Peter Mullin. I don't know whether you know Peter Mullin.
Yes.
And his, he's opened a museum of all his cars in Ventura. And he's given me freedom to go and choose and take the car outside, not on my own, because they're like $60 million or something crazy.
Let's start over here. The idea of the museum, Peter's idea, was that it be a tribute to the Art Deco movement.
It took me a long time to actually get the photographs and track it down. I'd seen it and wanted to photograph it. And I actually tracked it down maybe at the Newport Beach Concours d'Elegance. Mm-hmm. Of course, crowds of people around it, and another photographer came up and brushed them aside and said, "Let this lady take a picture."
Oh good.
And so I managed to get a picture of it. I didn't tell Peter that I'd done that. I'd previously done a painting of the Blue Delahaye for him, mm-hmm. which was a commission.
Mm-hmm. But this, I see.
Yeah, this one, he saw it at I showed it at Pebble Beach when I'd finished it. I still hadn't told him. I don't know why I didn't.
So you did the painting before he knew?
Yes.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah. And then he came in to Pebble Beach to our show and saw the painting right at the end of the show. I was all tired. I'd been to get all my packaging materials and stuff. And he said, "Nicola, there's only one person in the world that can own this painting."
That sounds like my brother. His favorite
this one.
Design, the teardrop Pablo Lago.
It's never been my favorite shape.
It doesn't.
No. Well, there are some other
from the aerodynamic design point of view.
It works.
You'll notice about these bumpers is that this industry came out of the aircraft industry.
Yes.
A lot of influence, as you know, from the aircraft industry. And so even these bumpers, and there's some other good examples.
Got the tail, the tail fin.
Yeah, they're almost like a wing.
Yeah.
To reduce drag and wind resistance.
They used the inspiration of the P-49 or P-39. Yeah, for the Cadillacs, you know, with the tail fins and.
We have a car upstairs.
Can you go hard round again? It's not as interesting as the other car. I'd like to shoot this one turn the opposite way round.
Port George.
That's a drag.
Yeah, we can do it, no problem.
No problem. That's fine.
You're good right here?
Yeah. Lovely. Thank you. I got a Fulbright scholarship from the Royal College of Art to Parsons School of Design in New York, and I didn't know until I got there that they didn't have a textile school, which was what I graduated in. Anyway, I did graphics and had this wonderful, Emil Antonucci was his name, a wonderful teacher who really encouraged me. It's teachers are so important. And when I was living on Bleecker Street, in the opposite apartment to me, blow me down, was Tom Wesselman. And he and I became friends. I was doing illustration, and he was doing his Great American Nude series, Great American Nude. And he was an inspiration to me, even though I don't paint like him at all, just because of the way he would paint, like round his nudes. It wouldn't just be the nude and then whatever came next to it. There would be a lovely like pink line or a different line going around it and painted beautifully. I always admired that about his work, because I'm a detail-oriented person too. Marilyn Monroe was a persona that I really felt for. I felt she wasn't treated right. I felt when she died, if she'd only talked to me, I could have helped her. I know that sounds crazy, but I just gravitated towards her. And I loved the movies that she made. They were sparkling. But she had something about her that made one feel for her, like as though she wasn't a sex symbol. She was a symbol of tender, you know, it brought out the tenderness in me in a way that I felt I could help her. I'm very excited about this painting. It's a very famous house to begin with. It's the case study, I think, 22. You probably can't see it, but there's a 60 Cadillac here. So one of the sons, one of these little guys in this picture, showed us around. And the 69 Cadillac I mean, the 60 Cadillac is designed with the same flavor as the architecture, which shows a nice continuity. See how the water is all flowing one way? The sky at the top, there's some little marks on the top of the canvas on the right. I might make the sky, do something with the sky to complement the water. I'm trying to sort out the very detailed rear end of this Cadillac. I'm just amazed when I look at something like this. I mean, I've been looking at Cadillacs for years, but how they ever designed such a thing when all the cars we see on the road now look like English taxis, little boxes. Apparently, Chuck Jordan went and looked at P-38s and were totally inspired by them. And you can see it on all of the cars. This looks to me a bit like an aeroplane, the lower part of this. You can almost smell the fuel. And the paper of the house for sale. And I like the sky so much that I used it as inspiration for the sky up there. I myself had a 62 Cadillac. They are, to me, absolute 20th century cultural landmarks. I saw the new Cadillac. It was in had a beautiful photograph. This is 2011 now, looking at a little tiny Cadillac with a rear end that only came from there to here, cut off with great big tail lights. It was a beautiful ad, but when you look at the difference in the design, all of this was like missing from the new Cadillac. The decoration, the decorative and imaginative. I think everybody would get really upset at the idea of having points like this as being, oh, too dangerous. And they would be banned. And now they're icons, which I love. My heart just skips a beat every time I see a beautiful 50s or 60s car. I've already had the lovely experience, of course, of driving my 62 down Pacific Coast Highway, listening to 50s and 60s music, watching the surfers. Very nice. Yeah, it's I'm very happy with it. It's coming along beautifully. It's slow, but it kind of speeds up towards the end, because then you're not that I paint faster, but it's inspirational. You've achieved so much, and then I want to continue. And it's not just paintings of cars or paintings of houses. It's the composition, and I mean, you would never find a sky like that. That's my inspiration. There, so the sky changes it. The color of the pool changes it. Putting a car in changes it. And it gives it a story, and it gives it, in this case especially, a wonderful composition of everything shooting off to the right there. It's a bit like the Barbie.
Yeah.
The Barbie and the 59 Cadillac. Mm-hmm. They were both born then. I realize now I've got something going here. So they belong together. But one of the nice things is that I got to paint downtown LA. It says so many things. It's all about, it shows you Los Angeles. I never realized that Los Angeles was like this. When I first came here, I was always looking for the city. You know, like London has got a center. And I never did discover downtown LA. Everything, I was always keep looking, where is LA? Where is, but it was all one-story houses, and it still is. So we've got Century City and downtown that kind of sprout up. And the airport in the middle here, and I live kind of just over here. Looking at it today for the first time in 3 days, I figured that I should start balancing up color, but just in this area here, to make it a little bit darker, perhaps. But apart from that, it's just about finished. So. In last week's Times, there's an open house on a Nutra house that is being sold for the first time in like 40 years, for instance. It's got this 50s feel, which I love. I love this house that I've just painted. So I figured I'd go to the open house. It's like 15 million. So I'm obviously not a prospective buyer, but I'll go to try and get into an open house there and photograph it. So yes, I'm definitely influenced by this painting. And I like the idea now of combining architecture of the same period and era as the cars. This was the canvas that did in my arm, painting this gradation. I had to do it all at once. In a day, I couldn't stop. So it was like 8 hours of yeah. Gradation. I'm thinking of changing the car. Mm-hmm. I want it. It's a Delahaye. It's a right-hand drive, of course, but I don't know what it is. I took several photographs of it last week. Oh, and this one is very nice. This is a Peter Mullen car. That's the Voison that they showed at this show. And I like I think that's a beautiful shape also. It's not sensual, but it's different and it has a beauty of its own.
Well, they were not quite the car. Maybe they just want to get a deep service.
She's with Woody's over there, and she come back and join us for lunch. Please do.
Okay.
Please do. It's so good to see you.
It's nice to see you.
But she's over there. She's over there with the Woody.
Is that another?
It's right over the fence, at the beginning of the fence where all the Woodies are.
Oh, it's a very famous house. A very famous photographer took a photograph of it.
Okay.
And I put it with a 60 Cadillac. Oh, and they're both the same design.
Oh,
and
my goodness.
And Sammy. I'm sorry you didn't buy that painting I did of your Mercedes.
Folks, you may not
really I sold it.
Well,
I sold it a long time ago. I'm exhibiting my work up in the arts tent, if you come up there. Nice to see you.
Hi, Nicola.
Hey.
How are you?
You saw me from with the eyes in the back of your head. How are you?
We'd still like to try to make arrangements for you to come in.
Yeah.
But... after the one date that we had set, and you weren't able to, things have just been kind of crazy.
Yeah.
And so we need
to... Well, it has for me too, actually.
Yeah. We have to make sure that we have the right people there.
So do you take a lot of wardrobe with you?
The whole thing. Yeah, it's got to go higher. Well, I'm going to be here all weekend.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
I know she likes that one over there.
She's got it.
Does she have that?
Yeah.
She already bought that?
Yeah, but not here.
Yeah.
I had another one made.
What size did she buy?
The same. It's actually the same.
The very same. We already bought it.
Right.
I'm sure glad we bought that because that's...
For
we
you.
Have that one, Karen.
You have that.
Oh, we have that one.
We have that.
I'm just going to get the
We plan. Love that. Well, we were going to buy another
there's
one.
Levels in all of them.
No. We know that we have that one there, so it's not a print.
And right.
The El Dorado.
We're going to call you later or email you and take you to dinner, and then we'll go through your studio and pick out a couple things. They will not, unfortunately, be the originals, but there'll be something like that.
Because, okay.
How's
lovely.
That? So we'll have a dinner, and then we'll go look through some things.
How you doing?
I'm doing very
You're looking
well.
Great as usual in the leopard skin, as usual.
The final award of excellence goes to... Nicola Wood.
Congratulations.
Thanks. I'm on the selection committee for who else might join the AFAS. And there's this artist that I was asked to look at. And she'll photograph a car or part of a car and put it into Photoshop, change it around a bit, then print it onto canvas. Is it a painting? What is a painting? I was amazed, frankly, because I spent hours, days, months, and they're getting the same effect without any work.
So how do we still maintain the hand of the artist in the work to make it unique?
Well, I'm not sure. You retain the hand, you retain the mind. I'm very happy with what I'm doing. But we do have these questions. But this new one has just come up. Well, what is art? What's the difference between art and illustration? Because we happen to have some artists who are illustrators in, and they all want to be called fine artists. It doesn't really matter, so long as it's beautiful and everybody loves it.